And here it is, Alan Freed's Rock and Roll Party. And here he is in person, Alan Freed.
Legendary Cleveland disc jockey Alan Freed is known around the world as the father of rock and roll. He promoted music through radio and television throughout the 1950s. And every year, the city of Cleveland pays tribute to Freed at the Moondog Coronation Ball, this being the 60th anniversary. And this year, his son Lance Freed is joining us here in the studio, and he's going to be there for the celebration. Lance, first of all, thank you so much for joining us this morning, gracing us with your presence.
Appreciate you stopping by. It's a pleasure to be here. Pleasure.
Wow, this is going to be a great event, no doubt about it. 60 years ago, did your father have any idea what he was doing and the impact this event would have?
He knew that he loved the music he was playing, but on radio station WJW, where he was broadcasting as the king of the Moondoggers, he decided to throw a dance and crown himself king of the Moondoggers.
Okay.
So that was why it was called the Moondog Coronation Ball.
Yeah.
But he had only been broadcasting about 7 months, so he had no idea who his audience was, what the reach was, how popular the music was. There were no Arbitron ratings or whatever they call those ratings to determine how big an audience was.
Take a look at your dad right there. Now, he was a trailblazer, being a white DJ on a white radio station, playing what they called back then race music. Talk about that.
Well, nobody was doing it. There may have been a couple of white disc jockeys playing this music, but this was music of color.
Yeah.
And we were talking 12 to 13 years before pre-civil rights movement in America. It just wasn't an accepted practice for blues and rhythm records.
Why did he do it? He just didn't care? Or was he just willing to take the chance? Or what was his thought process?
No, he did care. He had hooked up with a fellow named Leo Mintz at a place called the Record Rendezvous, which later became known as the VU here in Cleveland. He went down and watched and listened to the kids who were buying these records, and it was amazing because they weren't being played anywhere. The records were being played nowhere on any radio station, but they were flying out there like people were buying them like flapjacks.
Yeah.
So he decided that to start listening, and he became a big fan of the music.
Talk about that first coronation ball. There was some concern on your dad's part. Talk about that conversation that you had around the dinner table with your dad.
It's the one thing that I was 4 years old at the time that we don't remember too much when we were four. Mm-hmm. But I do remember that there was concern that there were only 800 tickets or so that had been sold.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact was, my father and my stepmother, Jackie, said, if this doesn't work out, we may have to move to a smaller place.
Yeah.
And for somebody who's 4 years old, I remember that had a big impact. Like, why are we going to have to move? And why is he throwing a dance? Why would anybody pay money to dance around the room?
As history would have it, people showed up in droves.
People did show up in droves. I mean, the pre-ticket sales were not spectacular at all. That's part of the concern. But the day of the show, March 21, 1952, about 9,000 tickets were sold, and it looked like it was going to be a big success.
Yeah, incredible. A lot of folks couldn't get in, I understand.
Well, actually, more people showed up than there were tickets available. About 25,000 people showed up for a dance to the Moondog Coronation Ball, where he was going to coronate himself King of the Moondoggers.
Yeah. And this year, we're talking, the 60th anniversary, which is incredible in itself. And you're here in town. What's your role over the weekend? What's going to happen?
Well, my role is to basically be back here to celebrate just like everybody else.
Okay.
I haven't been back for a Moondog Coronation Ball. It's been years and years. And And this is an anniversary. It's not quite as sexy as the 50th anniversary.
Yeah.
Or the 100th anniversary.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, it seemed like a good thing to attend, and I wanted to be here because most people focus on the end of my father's career mm-hmm. and not on the beginning.
Not
and
on
this
the beginning.
Is a celebration.
Yes.
The beginning of music, bringing people of diverse racial and economic backgrounds together through music.
One final question. What do you think your father would think about how music has evolved today?
I think he'd be pretty happy. You know, he loved music and anything that brought people together to celebrate. Music was fine with him. Uh-huh. That's what he cared about the most. And music is something that moves all of us.
It does, no doubt about it. You know? Real quickly, information about the coronation ball. What is it going to be? What date is it?
It's tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Tomorrow evening, the 31st mm-hmm. of March. Mm-hmm. I think it's 7:00 mm-hmm. at the Quicken's.
Yeah, Quicken Loans Arena.
Yeah.
Absolutely. You'll be there along with a lot of performers. It's going to be a huge event, man.
Yeah, Sam Moore and a few other folks.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be fun.
Yes, it is.
You know, and it's a pleasure to be here. To say hi to all the people in Cleveland because this is the city where it all started.
That's right. Rock and roll, born right here.
Rock and roll.
Lance,
thank you very much.
Lance Freed, thank you very much, man, for sharing. And the pictures were excellent. You as a little boy and your dad and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Thank you very much once again for stopping by.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
Appreciate it.
Thank
There's
you.
A lot more Fox 8 News in the morning still ahead. We're back in two. Stay with us.